Number 92 in your hymnals. Oh, how I love Jesus. We'll start this Sunday with that. Let's stand together. There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing His word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because He first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died and set me free. It tells me of His precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because He first loved me. On the last. It tells me of no one whose loving heart can give me flow. With without rose in the court, if none could bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because He first loved me. Good singing. Let's go now to 139. Number 139. Great is Thy faithfulness. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great
glad God is faithful. Great is His faithfulness. I'll tell you why, because mine is not all that great, and I have to depend upon the Lord all the time, and I'm so glad He never changes. Yesterday, today, and forever, He is the same. Great is His faithfulness. It's good to see you here this morning. I'm glad you were able to make it to church. We do want to pray for our pastor and his family especially, because he's under the weather, and I think I heard that Miss Pam is under the weather as well, and Johnny is as well. So they've got some sickness going on around there. So Heather was under the weather. She's doing better now. And so how's he this morning, Heather? Is he doing okay? hanging in there. Well, good. Yeah, amen. And just pray that he can take the rest that he needs, because I know Pastor well enough to know that he's always wanting to go. And anyway, pray for him that he'll get better, and the rest of the family as well, that they'll feel much better and that he'll heal quickly. So let's have a word of prayer. Ask the Lord to be with this request especially. Father, we do thank thee so much for this wonderful day that thou hast given to us, the privilege it is to attend church in the freedom of America. And we pray, Lord, that thou hast opened our hearts to receive the word of God this morning. We pray especially for our pastor and his family, Miss Pam. We think of little Johnny. We pray, Lord, that that thou hast healed them quickly and completely. And we thank thee, Lord, that Heather is feeling better now and she's able to be here. And Lord, just the sickness that's going around. There may be some others, Lord, that are not feeling well either. And I know that we have a couple in the church that were out with sickness for the last couple of weeks. And I do pray, Lord, that thou hast healed them and get them back to where they're able to do the things that they're used to doing around their home and their work, perhaps. We thank thee again, Lord, for all that thou hast done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. There's just a couple of announcements that I want to give. Of course, don't forget to continue to pray for one another, especially the pastor and his family. And then I think there was a couple more, and it just slipped my mind who it was, but there's a couple more that are fighting over sickness and trying to get better and should be close to it maybe. But pray for one another. You know, we don't hear as much about the sickness now, but they're still going around some things. So do pray for one another. I do want to mention a couple of announcements. There are some sign-up sheets in the back there on the table. One is for church cleanup, and one is for special music and that sort of thing. And I encourage you to go back there and take a look and see maybe there's something that you can do to help in the ministry of the church. And so I encourage you to go back there. If you see something you might be able to do, go ahead and sign your name down there. And if you need some help with something, just let somebody know. And we'll try to do that, get you some help so that you're able to perform that ministry. The men's prayer meeting, which was supposed to be yesterday, has been postponed until this coming Saturday. But that's contingent on how the pastor feels as well. So we're just going to kind of play that one by ear, and the pastor will get you an email or something out letting you know more about that. And then also, is it too late to get the letters and pictures and things for the Cushels? Okay. So let's make it today. If you have like a letter or a picture or anything that you want to put together for the Cushels, to send, give it to Heather either sometime this evening, I guess, would be appropriate as well. All right. I'm going to have the ushers come on down. And if you're here today visiting with us, we certainly appreciate you spending the time with us this morning. And we want to know if you're here visiting, if you would just lift your hand. If you're a first-time visitor, our ushers have something for you. And if you would fill that out and just put it in the offering plate when it comes by, we'd appreciate it very much. And so we thank you so much if you're visiting for being here with us today. And as soon as they get back there, I'll let them grab the grab their offering plates and come on back up, fellas. All right, we're going to have our offering here, and I'm going to ask as soon as Jason, you get up here into your position, we'll let you say the prayer for the offering, if that's all right. Thank you.
Thank you, Holly.
All right, let's stand one more time and turn, if you will, to number 774, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. 774 in your hymnals.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound evermore, and the Lord of the Lamb will bring and bear, when the Savior of us shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder over there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there on the third. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn to night. Let us talk of all the wonders of and care. Then when all of life is over and the work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Good singing. All right. Let's turn and do a chorus for the month. The new one for August is going to be on 161 in your hymnals. Page 161, I will sing of the mercies.
I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, with my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness to all generations. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord with my mouth.
That's all right. Sorry. Thanks. All right. Shake hands.
Thank you.
Let's sing our chorus together one more time. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing, I will sing. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. With my mouth will I make known thy faithfulness, with thy mouth. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I will sing of the mercies of the Lord. Good singing. You may be seated.
There's no power in the water, be it the mighty Mississippi or the Jordan when it floods. There's no power in the water to take away our sin. The power's in the blood.
God sent John the Baptist to preach and make a way for the Savior who would save the whole world through. John baptized with water, said one more powerful would come, but there was something even John the Baptist knew.
There's no power in the water, be it the mighty Mississippi or the Jordan when it floods. There's no power in the water to take away our sin. The power's in the blood.
At the pool of Bethesda, Jesus met a man with an illness 40 years could not dispel. He was waiting by the water to be healed when Jesus said, take up your bed and walk, you've been made well.
There's no power in the water, be it the mighty Mississippi or the Jordan when it floods. There's no power in the water to make us new again. The power's in the blood. There's no power in the water, be it the mighty Mississippi or the Jordan when it floods. There's no power in the water to take away our sin. The power's in the blood to make us new again. The power's in the blood.
Amen. There is no power in the water. Or if you're from the south, water. If you're from the north, water. Luke chapter 17. If you would, turn your Bibles there. Luke chapter 17. And we're going to look at a passage of Scripture that is very familiar. Luke chapter 17. And we're going to look at starting at verse 11. We'll go through verse 19. And you children can be dismissed if you haven't already. I'm glad somebody pointed that out as I looked up. Somebody waving at me. Children. All right, are they all gone? All right. Luke chapter 17, starting at verse 11. Let's look at these verses real quick. And it came to pass, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go show yourselves unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, Were there not 10 cleansed, but where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, Arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Father, again, we do thank thee so much for the opportunity to open thy word. And we thank thee for the freedom to worship in this country again. We pray, Lord, that thou wouldst help us to pray not only for our continued freedom, for our leaders, and Lord, we also pray for everything that's going over there with Israel. We pray that thou wouldst keep your hand of protection on her. Thank thee again. We pray again for our pastor and his family that are not feeling well. Please heal them quickly. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, and thank you so much. A picture of thankfulness. You know, we live in a world today that thankfulness is really not even part of the question, is it? Especially, what do they call it? Entitlement. We're entitled for everything. If I ever said that when I was growing up to my dad, he showed me what I was entitled to. And, your parents may have been the same way. But today, everybody's entitled. You know, I'm entitled to this, I'm entitled to that. And it used to be, before it became entitlement, it was, I have my rights kind of thing, you know. And so today's world, thankfulness is not really part of the vocabulary. Thank you. It's kind of weird to hear somebody say thank you, you know, when you do something for them. Thank you. And you're sort of like, what? You know. And but it's a good thing to practice. Being thankful for what is going on in our lives that someone blesses us with, or especially if the Lord blesses us. Now, the Lord here was on his way to Jerusalem, and on his journey, he goes through Samaria. And that's in verse 11 where you find that. Some suggest that between Luke 17:10 and Luke 17:11, the events of John 11 takes place. And this is where Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. They have suggested that. I don't know. A lot more smarter individuals than I am have come up with that, so I'll just take their word for it. Now, we don't know exactly where the Lord was here in this chapter, but somewhere in the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he's coming into the Samaria, or where he's headed, he comes across 10 lepers. Now, leprosy is a picture of sin in the Bible, but he comes across 10 lepers, and these lepers are standing on the outside where they were supposed to be. They couldn't go into the city. They were leprous, and so they had to stay on the outside. And as people approached to where they may have been, they were to stand there and say, unclean, to let them know, don't come any closer, I have leprosy. And so they were out there doing that, basically. But when they saw the Lord coming, now it doesn't say this in the scriptures, but the Lord's reputation had already preceded him. They knew who he was. And they saw him coming, and they holler out, Lord, Savior, Master, have mercy on us. Now, folks, can I just emphasize something in a parenthesis here in the sermon? If you have never accepted Jesus Christ, all of us are born in sin. We are born with a sinful nature. For all have sinned and come short of what? The glory of God. Do you know what the glory of God is? It's Jesus Christ. We have come short of his standard. And the term there, come short of the glory of God, come short, literally means that as an archer pulls an arrow back on his bow and he's going to shoot at a target, he does this. We take the words come short means that we almost hit it. It's exactly the opposite. We're not even close. As a matter of fact, we're shooting our arrow in the wrong direction. And so all have sinned. You and I were born into sin. We've all come short of God's glory. John chapter 3 tells us there is none righteous. No, not one. If you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you are still in a sin nature. You are still, as the Bible puts it, a leper, unclean, have come short of the glory of God. May I say, I don't want to leave you there. Because just as Jesus healed these lepers, Jesus Christ came to this earth, was born of a virgin, had a ministry, and at the age of 33 was put on the cross for your sins and for mine. He shed his precious blood for you personally so that you could have eternal life with him forever. You know, someone once told me, he said, oh, I serve a loving God, and God would never do that. And I say to you, you're right. God never chose for you to be in sin and to reject Jesus Christ and to die and spend eternity in hell. But our own free will, our own volition said, we're going to disobey God. We're going to rebel against God, and we're going to suffer the consequences. And you know what is amazing? That out of love, God sent his only son to die for us. And it's even more amazing that God and the Trinity created this world knowing full well that we would need a Savior. That amazes me. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You don't have to stay as one of those lepers who hollers unclean. But you can accept the grace of God and the mercy of God and be cleansed from all unrighteousness. It's a choice. It's a choice that you, each individual must make. If you've never made that decision, I urge you and beg you, don't take it for granted that you'll have another breath or another opportunity. No man knows when his last breath will be taken. And so do not gamble with your soul. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, Paul said. And I surely hope and pray that you all, in this and in my voice and on Facebook or wherever you may be watching this, YouTube, I pray and hope that you are ready to meet the Savior one day. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior? I want you to see a couple of things here. In verses 12 through 14, we find the diseased ten. The condition that they were in verse 12, if you look at that. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And I've explained a lot of that already. And so as we move on into this passage, I want you to see the cry in verse 13 that they gave. The cry. They cried out. Now, may I say this? If you're here today or under the sound of my voice or you're watching this, there is a cry that the Lord is wanting to hear from you. It is a cry of begging for forgiveness. Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've sinned against the holy God. I know I deserve hell, but I'm crying for your mercy. I need your grace. I need your mercy. And I place my faith in what you have done. The Lord is still listening for that cry. And so they cried out. Their cry was to Jesus, the only one who could help them. Their cry was for mercy. And as I've mentioned, Jesus is the only one who can help us with the disease of sin. No one else can. We can't be good enough
for God to accept us. You see, God looks at us right now in our sin, let's say. God looks at us as a judge. And he looks to see the righteousness. Do you have the righteousness, enough righteousness to come into heaven? God looks at us as we stand in our sin, and he looks at us and he says, no, nowhere close. There is none righteous, no, not one. And God looks at the sinner who stands before him and he says, you're guilty. There's no righteousness found in you. Oh, but listen, the 10 lepers, they cried out to Jesus Christ. They said, we're not righteous, but we know someone who is, and here he comes. Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on us. And Jesus Christ, who is righteous, turned to them, and he said, go thy way and show yourself unto the priest at the temple. And as they turned, they were healed as they went their way through faith. Through their faith in what Jesus could do. Listen, folks, it's not by our works of righteousness. It's by our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that saves us. There's no other way unto heaven. There's no other way to receive righteousness except through him. He is the only way. The world will tell you there's multiple ways. You can get to heaven this way. You can get to God that way. You can listen. Jesus himself said in John, I am the way. I am what? The truth. I am the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And listen, that has never changed. It is through Christ and Christ alone that you and I have any hope of gaining heaven. It is through his righteousness. And when I get saved, as I've explained before on occasion, when I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior, Jesus washes me clean. He puts a cloak of righteousness around me, his righteousness. And when I stand in front of God Almighty, he looks at me as the great judge. He says, where's the righteousness? And he sees Christ's righteousness. I'm enveloped in Christ's righteousness, not mine. And he says, you're pure, you're righteous, enter thou into glory. Oh, it's a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing, and it's a gift. You know, we call it a free gift because it's free to us. But it was not free to Christ. It cost him everything. He came. He died on the cross. He shed every drop of blood. He was buried. But thank God, on the third day, that stone rolled away and Jesus Christ himself came out and presented himself glorious again the way he was when he came from heaven. But now, the price has been paid. There's redemption given to all if you'll accept it. I urge you, I beg of you, don't let this go by. Jesus is coming soon. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18 tells us that one day he's coming and there's going to be a shout. And the dead in Christ will rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them into clouds. And so shall we be forever. And then in verse 18 it says, wherefore, because of that, encourage one another with these words. How many of you have a loved one that's already gone on to be with the Lord? I do. I just did a funeral this week of a lady that I loved. That I grew up. But we may have put the body down in the ground, but I can tell you one thing. There's coming a day, if I'm still alive and that day comes, she's going to raise up from the ground first. And I've always said the reason they go first is because they got 6 feet to go. But she's coming first. All of our loved ones in the Lord who are dead and buried are coming first. And we're going to join them in the air one day. And we'll all be changed to be like him because we'll see him as he is. I am looking forward to that day. To get rid of this old body. And to have a perfect body. Have a sinless body. That's more important to me than anything. How many of you struggle with that on a daily basis? I do. You know, there's just in the scriptures, there's several places where you find people who cry out to the Lord. Two blind men cried out to the Lord in Matthew chapter 9, verse 27. They cried out for his mercy and they were healed. The woman of Canaan in Matthew chapter 15, verse 22, cried out to the Lord, cried out for mercy, and her daughter was healed. The father cried out to the Lord in Matthew 17, verse 15, for God's mercy on his son who was possessed with a devil, and the boy was given mercy. I want you to notice, too, their faith was tested here. It was tested. Jesus told them to go and show themselves to the priest, and as they went, they were healed. You know, in the scriptures, most of the time, I think, as Jesus healed someone, their faith is what the Bible says, what makes them whole or heals them. Do you remember the man with the withered arm? And Jesus came up, and the man with the withered arm, he begged for mercy. And the Lord did what? The Lord said, stretch forth thine hand. Now, if the man would have kept it like this, would it have been healed? No. When did the healing take place? When he began to stretch forth his hand, and the hand was made whole like unto the other one. You see, there is an action to faith. It's one thing to say, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that he's a good man. I believe all of these things. I believe there was a man named Jesus and that he died on the cross for our sins. That's one thing to say that. But it's quite another to take it from here, 18 inches down to here. And to say, I believe, I'm placing my faith in what he did for me. And that is the only way to be saved, is to place my faith in him. There's a big difference in just believing. Matter of fact, the book of James tells us that the devils believe and tremble. The devils believe and tremble. Do you? Do you believe in Jesus Christ as the only way to salvation? Some people are looking for just a miracle with no responsibility. Just a miracle. Just heal me. That's all I want. But don't ask me to do anything else beyond that. There was a lady that I knew that literally told me these words. And if you don't believe me, my wife was there. You can ask her. She's doing a children's thing. Literally told me these words to my face. She said, as long as I get to heaven by the skin of my teeth, that's all I care. I at that point questioned her whether she was getting to heaven. Because I'm going to tell you something. When Christ saved me, there was a whole lot more to just skin of the teeth salvation. He changed me. Corinthians tells us that we are changed. Old things have what? Passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Why? Because we're new creations in Christ. We're new creatures in Christ. And when Jesus Christ saved my soul, I may have been a good person, by the way. Hadn't really done anything wrong and that kind of thing. Oh, I know we all sin. You understand what I'm saying. I wasn't out there doing things that shouldn't have been doing to begin with. But Christ changed me. He made me new. If you knew the old Greg, you wouldn't like him. Hopefully you like the new one. See, that remains to be seen. All right. So now some approach salvation the same way without any faith. They just want to be saved from the fire, as I've mentioned. Now, in Ephesians chapter 2, it's a great picture of saving faith. For by grace, whose grace? God's grace. For by grace are you saved, how? By faith. Through faith. And that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God. You know why? Because we'd boast. We'd boast. Look what I'm good enough to get saved. I'm good enough for heaven. I talked to a man one time in Greenville, North Carolina. And as I was waiting on a friend of mine to come out of surgery, he had a pacemaker put in. And I'm sitting in the lobby waiting for him. And I got to talking with a man who was waiting for his wife. And we began to talk, and I began to tell him about the Lord. And eventually I asked him, how do you get to heaven? His answer was, I believe you do the best you can, and God will work it all out. I said, well, sir, your best doesn't even reach the lowest point of the standard. He said, well, what do you mean? And I gave him some scriptures. And I said, you know, how good do you have to be to go to heaven? Just how many works? And if it's based on my works and going to heaven, how good I am, then what do I have to do to break that? What do I have to do bad to break that? Well, to make a long story short, he said, you know, I haven't really thought about it. So I gave him my little New Testament I had. I already had verses marked in it. And I gave him that New Testament. And I said, would you promise me that you'll start here, and I've already written where to go next? He said, I promise you I'll do that. And before he left, we made introductions again. And I asked him, said, what do you do for a living? He goes, oh, I'm one of the vice presidents over here at the school in Greenville. I forgot the name of Greenville University. East Carolina, thank you. I could see the logo, I couldn't get the name. But he said, I'm one of the vice presidents over here at East Carolina. And I said, sir, you're a very intelligent man. Please do not depend on your own intelligence. Depend on what Jesus has already done for you. And then secondly, in verses 17 and 18, the disappointing nine. So you had one that turned and said thank you to Jesus. Christian, before I hit this point, can I just ask you something? When was the last time you thanked the Lord for your salvation? When was the last time you said, Lord, thank you for loving me and having mercy and grace on me, because I don't know where I'd be. I don't know what I'd be doing today, even if I was alive. Sometimes I spend time in prayer with the Lord. I got to a certain age, and, you know, I'm next month I'll be 62. I know it's hard to tell, right? Come on, flatter me. Now, so next month I'll be 62. Well, I hit a certain age and the body changed, the inward body, and my clock got broke. And at 3 o'clock, it's always telling me at 3 o'clock, you're supposed to get up. Anybody else have that problem? Somewhere around 3, 3:30? I don't know what it is. But anyway, about 3:30 in the morning, my brain says, okay, hey, you know, you need to get on up. And so I'll get up, and I listen to my brain once in a while. And so I get up, and then I'll do whatever, and then I come back to bed. And then when I'm laying there in bed, 3:30 or so, my brain says, okay, well, you're up, so I'm just going to start thinking about everything. Anybody else have that problem? Thank you. I'm glad I'm not alone in this. So I have purposefully developed this habit. It takes a while, but I purposely developed this habit, and I encourage you to do the same if you have trouble going back to sleep. Lay there and start going through your prayer list and praying through your prayer list. Now, I've done that so many times, I've got mine memorized. But I'll go through my prayer list, and I'll say, oh, you know, I'll ask the Lord about this or that. And I try to never forget, Lord, I need your grace and your mercy today. I need your grace and I need your mercy, especially today. And especially if the Lord put somebody on your mind, you pray for them. You may not know anything's going on in their life. You may not have seen them in a long time. But if the Lord puts them on your mind, say a word of prayer for them. I'll tell you why it's important. I'll try to get through it. I was raised in church all my life. I went to college, and in 1979, I got rebellious. And I decided to leave college, and while I was waiting for my brother-in-law to come pick me up in Greenville, South Carolina, I was at Bob Jones University. On the corner of that college, where my dorm was, I was standing on the corner, had all my stuff. And I will never forget looking up into heaven with a rebellious attitude, saying to the Lord, you show me what the world is like, and I'll decide whether I want to serve you. Just a few months later, I joined the Army. Didn't want anybody to tell me what to do. I literally walked into the recruiter. I said, sign me up for 20. He laughed and said, I can't. I wish I could, but I can't. So I signed up for 4. Left, went to boot camp, went to AIT, went on over to Fort Lewis, Washington first, then went over to Italy. In Italy, it was getting close to the end of my time, and the Lord put a sickness on me, allowed a sickness to come on me. I ended up in the hospital, in a room in quarantine, by myself, no television, no nothing, just me in a bed. And when I finally regained enough mental capabilities, I knew the Lord was saying, make your choice. Make your choice. I knew I was saved. I had accepted Christ years before, but I had never fully surrendered. The Lord was saying, you better make your choice now. Be warned, folks. If you ever get to that position, you're not guaranteed you'll make the right choice. Because I struggled with that choice. I've heard people say, I'll get saved later. I want to live my life now. I'll get saved later. you, number one, may not have later, and number two, you may not make the right choice. And I said, I struggled within myself, and so help me. God in his mercy sent a missionary that I did not know was even around to my door. Knocked on my door. And I said, come in. And this missionary walked into my room. And he told me, he said, I don't know why God directed me here. And I said, I do. And I told him all that I've told you. And he began to pray with me. And he asked God to give me the grace and the mercy and the strength to make the right choice. And he left. It was about a day later that I said, Lord, I am nothing without you. You see, humility has to come first. Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Humility comes first. And when I pled with the Lord to forgive me and to help me, it was less than 4 hours I was completely well. And to this day, they didn't know what it was. I know what it was. God holding me accountable. These disappointing nine were there. He healed the one, or healed all of them. One turned around and said, thank you. And then the disappointing nine, verses 17 and 18, Jesus answered and said, were there not 10? You see, here's the thing. You meet some Christians who are thankful for what God's done for them. Now, I'm going to tell you, I've met Christians who are on fire for God and thankful for what God's done for them, and just a joy unspeakable and full of glory. And I've met them, and they're just thankful for what God's done, and they're great to be around. They're great to be around. They talk about the Lord. They just enjoy the Lord, your company, and talking about the Lord. I'm going to tell you, that is a wonderful person to be around. But I've also met some who were just thankful to be saved. And that was it. That was the extent. These nine are like that. Jesus said, where are the nine? We have the answer in verse 18. There are not found. Where are they? They were healed too. Where are they? They're not found. I say this just to really tell us. Jesus saved our souls. Let's not throw that free gift of salvation back at him. Let's be thankful. Let's serve him. Let's do all we can. Let's burn out for Christ. When Christ lit that candle of salvation in your soul, that little fire, there's a Hebrew word in Psalm 37. It says, fret not thyself. And it's a Hebrew word. And I'm not going to try to pronounce it because it would just come out as mush. But it literally means that there's a little fire. And in the illustration, fret not thyself because of evildoers in Psalm 37, the little fire, it actually means don't blow on that little fire and kindle it up, okay? But it's talking about fretting. But in our hearts, we have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit was a flaming fire. It came out of heaven. Remember how it came and lit upon the heads of the ones that were up in the upper chamber? We ought to be flaming that up. We ought to be, Lord, give me that flame, that exciting fire that shows the power of the Holy Spirit in our hearts and lives. Sometimes you talk about the power of the Holy Spirit and people look at you like, And maybe we're afraid to talk about it. You know, don't want anybody to think we're something we're not. When was the last time the power of the Holy Spirit that you felt in your life? When was the last time that the power of the Holy Spirit was so predominant in your heart that you knew it? That your heart was so full of joy that it flooded out of your eyes. And you couldn't help it. When was the last time you spent time in prayer with God and the Holy Spirit just moved in your heart and in your soul? And there was a special moment that you just could not explain. When was the last time that the Lord allowed someone to come across your path and you began to tell them about Jesus Christ and the power of God came through? And you could see the conviction and the guilt in that person's heart and soul and on their face. And you could tell that the Holy Spirit was moving. When was the last time? Or has there been a time? If there hasn't been a time when you have felt the Holy Spirit move in your heart and in your life and see something change and see something happen, you ought to be down here praying, God, fill me with your power. Fill me with your power so that I can do what thou hast called me to do. We have too many Christians today that are like the nine. They're looking for God the genie to come down and to do whatever it is that they ask. And then they turn around and continue to move on. Don't be that type of person. Don't be the nine. Be the one. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Fill me with thy spirit. Help me, Lord, to be all that you have called me to be. Help me, Lord, not to falter and waver. Help me, Lord, to walk the straight path. Help me, Lord, to encourage my fellow brothers and sisters in the Lord. Help me, Lord, to tell people about you when I come across their path and when I have the opportunity. Help me, Lord, to pray for them on a daily basis. Lord, keep my heart and my mind pure so that I have nothing that will hinder the working of the Holy Spirit in the lives, not only of me, but of others. Help me, Lord, to love you. Do you love him? He loves you. One of the worst things I think that there could be is to give your love to someone who doesn't love you back. What kind of a relationship is that? We are his bride. Isn't that wonderful? We're his bride. Gentlemen, if you married a woman and you loved her with all your heart and would give yourself for her, and she did not love you back, the hurt would be unimaginable. You know, God told us husbands to love our wives because the women don't have a difficult time loving. They naturally love. It's a natural thing for them. But sometimes in a marriage relationship, there are ladies who do not love back. And I've talked to men, and it hurts so deeply. I say that to say this. We have a God that loves us. For God so loved the world. He loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son. That whosoever, anyone, whosoever believes or believeth in him and what he did for us shall not perish but have everlasting life. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, our loving Savior came and died for all of us. You individually. If you're here and you're saved, do you love him like he loved you? Like he loves you? Are you experiencing the power of the Holy Spirit in your life? If you are, you ought to be able to, with testimony, to stand immediately and say, hey, I want to give testimony to the power of the Holy Spirit in my life and what God has done for me and through me. We ought to be. I'm telling you. Peter tells us what? Always be ready to give an account of the hope which lieth within us. Every Christian in this room, everyone in this room who has been saved, ought to be able to stand in a moment's notice, if they were pointed to, and say, tell me what God's done for you in your life today. Ought to. But sometimes when you call for testimonies, let me get on behind this guy. It ought not be that way. If you're here today and you've never experienced on a personal level the love of God for you personally, I want to invite you to come when we have the invitation, and I'm going to have Miss Holly come on and get to the piano. We're going to have an invitation. Listen, if you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, I want to encourage you to come today. Just come forward. Tell me, say, I've never accepted Christ. I will get someone to show you out of God's word how to be saved. Thou shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Thou shalt be saved. Confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus Christ. Thou shalt be saved. Let's stand. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, can I just, with no one looking around, can I just ask this question? If you're here today, the most important thing is that you know you're saved. You know you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, that beyond a shadow of a doubt, if something were to happen, if you were to drop dead where you stand, or the Lord was to come back, if something like that were to happen, you say, Brother Greg, I know. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt I'm going to heaven. Would you lift your hand just in testimony? I know I'm going to be with the Lord. Amen. You can put those down. Maybe you're here and you say, I'm not sure. I just don't know. I don't have that peace in my heart that I know that I would be with the Lord if something were to happen. And Brother Greg, would you pray? I'm not going to call you out. I just want to acknowledge, and then I will pray for you. Anyone here would want me to pray for them specifically on that matter. All right. How about Christian? How about this? You say, Brother Greg, I've experienced the power of the Lord in my life before, but I got to tell you, has been a dry spell. And I want you to pray for me that I'll get that back. I'll feel God move in my life again. Not just an emotional feel, but a godly understanding of that. And that I'll see some changes in my life and in the lives of others as a result of my fellowship and relationship with God. And I want you to pray for me that I'll surrender everything to the Lord and let Him do with me as He will. Anyone, you want me to pray with you about that? Would you lift your hand? Yes, I see that hand. I see that hand. Yes. Lord, I do pray for all of those that may be here that were just too timid to say, Lord, Brother Greg, I'm not really sure if I'm saved. But Lord, maybe in their heart you're moving. And I pray, Lord, that you would help them to understand the importance, to not put it off, and that they would accept you as your Savior, as their Savior. And then, Lord, for those who say, I haven't felt the power of the Holy Spirit in my life in a while, and I really would like, I'd love to have that, and to feel that and experience that power again. We're not talking about some emotional thing that comes and goes, but Lord, a real deep sense of God working in our hearts and lives. I pray for those who asked prayer for that. And Lord, I pray that whatever it is that may be hindering that, that I was make that prevalent in their minds so that they can confess those things to Thee. Be with us as we have our invitation in Jesus' name. Amen. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed as Miss Holly plays the invitation, if you'd like to come and pray at the altar, feel free to do so. I want to thank you for coming this morning. I pray that you'll be back tonight at 6 o'clock. We have our evening service. And don't forget to pray for the pastor. Now, he needs to get the rest, and we want to encourage him and all that. But if you send him a text, I would encourage you, and Pastor, if you're looking at this, I'm telling them to, if they send you a text, just put on there, you don't need to respond. I just want to tell you, we love you and praying for you, okay? Because he's got to have rest, you know what I mean? And he can't, you know, his thumbs get wore out. But you do continue to pray for him. We would appreciate that very much. And for Miss Pam and for Johnny as well. And lift them up in the Lord. All right? All right. Well, let's have a word of prayer and we'll be dismissed. And thank you again so much for being here. Brother Chick, how about praying for him?